Nellie Mitchell.
My name's Bill Zarakotis.
My name's Carolee Davison.
My name is Richard Pratt, but everybody calls me Dick or Hey You or something like that.
I'm Daisy Day.
Ruth, my maiden name was Huckins Hammond.
Marty Fiery.
Alan W. Davidson.
Priscilla.
Barbara Fangione.
During the time that you were growing up.
How would I know that?
The first Wall Street crash.
Okay.
That's the thing I remember most.
I was born on December the 10th, 1941. Now, if you picked up the newspaper on December the 8th, 1941, the Boston Herald, this is what you would have read.
World War II had just gotten over, and President Eisenhower was our president. He had been a general in World War II.
When I was born, it was 1924, and it was an up time. I don't know how versatile you are in your history. But that was there were boom times until the 1929 when the crash. And I was, what, six?
What kind of childhood diseases did you have or catch?
And following the Wall Street crash was an epidemic. And I say epidemic because it was literally house to house. Neighborhood to neighborhood.
On my seventh birthday, I had measles and I had on Easter Sunday. And I was 7 years old on Easter Sunday.
All the regular ones that children don't get anymore. The mumps, measles, chicken pox.
What kinds of food did you eat? Did you go to the store often or make most of your food? Did you have any favorite food?
My mother was a wonderful cook. People in Chichester knew her as the whoopie pie lady because she made the best whoopie pies there ever were. We belonged to the Congregational Church, so the suppers during the summer, we had a church supper every 2 weeks. And my mom made lemon meringue pies. She made 8 of them for every supper. There was a man who came up from Massachusetts just to buy one of the pies.
I think we ate everything we had. Baked beans every Saturday night. I really liked them. Mm-hmm. My father did not like tomatoes, so I never had a tomato until I was married.
I was always homegrown, homemade. My mother was a wonderful cook, and my grandmother had a Finnish restaurant and Finnish people, so everything was done from scratch. We had a lot of root vegetables because that's what they live on, carrots and beets and turnips and things growing around, potatoes.
Peanut butter and jelly, 7 days a week, 365 days a year.
Where did you go to school? One room school, high school, college? Do you have any particular memories?
It was a lot of fun. We had a big stove right in the middle of the room. And sometimes it would smoke and we'd have to go out. But we had a good time there. And I was there for 8 grades. We had one teacher that would sit in the front of the room. And we had the 8 grades and she would teach first one grade and then another.
I was the oldest one because I was in the 5th grade. So I had to take care of the stove. We had a wood stove. and we had wood, and I had to cut it up, put it in there, get there early and do it. And they said, well, there's one good thing here. You're going to get 25 cents a month for doing that. But you got to come earlier than that at others. And my mother didn't like it because she said, I don't have you do that at home. Why are you? I said, Mom, you don't realize I've been doing it. Different ones have different chores. Usually the boy, my brother is 4 years older, his job was to come home, cut the kindling wood, bring it upstairs and start the fire. We had a wood furnace, but we had wood in the kitchen. And he was supposed to do that so that I could put the potatoes on, because they always put potatoes on. So I get home right after him. Naturally, I couldn't walk with him. Get home right after that, and he wouldn't be around. And I'd say, okay, now what do I do? I'd wash off the potatoes, get them all ready in the kettle with the water. All right, guess I have to go downstairs. The first time I did it, I think I was 9 years old. I went downstairs, says, I don't know about this, and I'm cutting up the kindling wood and bringing it upstairs and starting the fire. And I got the fire going, and I got the potatoes on, so nothing was said. Well, I kept doing that. One day I got home and I just said, I probably was 9 or 10, maybe 9. I said, that's it, because my job, besides putting potatoes on, girls only had certain jobs, boys only had certain jobs in those days. I had to go upstairs with a dry mop, my mother's and my parents' bedroom, my bedroom, and my brother's. And then I had to make all the beds and come back downstairs. Well, I said, okay, this is it. I did my bed and dry mopped it, and did my parents and dry mopped it and made the bed. I didn't touch my brothers, and I went downstairs. Well, he came in about 5 minutes. He did that. He knew when they were going to get home, 5 minutes before they got home. And my mother says, I see the potatoes are on. Yep. My brother came in, and he went upstairs. He came down raving. You know what she did? I said, what did I do? You didn't make my bed, and you didn't dry mop the floor. Well, my mother says, my father says that, you're not. Well, then tell him he's supposed to get home and light the fire for me to put the potatoes on. Well, he does every day. I said, he hasn't at all. I've been doing it every day. You're lighting the fire? My mother almost had a fit.
And in New York, you take what is called regents. They're given by the state. It's a state test, and I got mumps the day before Regents in January, which meant, and I had taken algebra, and I had to take the second semester of algebra all over again, which wasn't a bad thing, because the teacher I got the second time was an awesome teacher, and if you didn't understand something this way, he could go around the block and tell you, show you another way. So I wound up acing it. I might have barely passed the first time.
So I thought I'd like to be a history teacher. So when I graduated from college, I taught 1 year, and I did a lousy job. I was a terrible teacher. And it was a three-room schoolhouse, and I had grades 6th, 7th, and 8th in one room, and I was not prepared for that at all.
I always wanted to teach, and I loved my teacher. We had at Conant School in Concord, we were in a special class. Well, the special class was they were going to try the experiment of teaching kids French with little children, because little people pick up on it, but usually it's very little people. We had a person from the high school come down and teach us French. What I remember mostly is we did songs and we did verbs and grammar.
Did you have any favorite activities, such as berry picking, apple picking, games, favorite books, etc.?
Riding bikes. So a bunch of us had bikes. We used to ride all over town. We didn't have TV even until 1951. We had our first TV in 51, We were the only ones in town that had a TV, so we had everybody coming over to watch TV at our house for a while. But we used to ride our bikes everywhere, and we had the Cranberry Boys. That's what we did, you know. And I wasn't into any competitive sports. Well, I'll take that back. I was a very good swimmer, and I won a lot of trophies and that sort of thing for my swimming until I got into high school, I guess. Different people owned the bogs, and then they sold them to Ocean Spray.
Okay.
And the bogs that were near us were surrounded by Cranberry Bogs. And the way the bogs are built, they're raised beds. Probably from the bottom of the ditch where the water is to the top is probably about 3 feet. And so in the winter, they flood them about a foot over to protect the vines. And that was our place to skate in the winter.
Okay.
And in the summertime, we would be down in the, you know, chasing frogs and shrimps and anything else that moved and riding our bikes.
But I always like to have a lot of fun.
Yeah, what do you do for fun?
Oh, well, I dressed up as a Cookie Monster. I was a clown, and I was a bunny rabbit.
Oh, fun.
And I was an animal for the filling station that her grandfather runs.
You were one of those people outside in the costume?
Yeah.
Waving.
Tony the Tiger.
I was into sports. Baseball, basketball, football.
We used to go blueberrying, yes. Up the road, up Staniels Road off Husqvarna Road there used to be so many blueberry bushes. You just had to be careful because heard any kind of noise, you had to really check it because the bears also like blueberries.
I grew up with all boys in the neighborhood, so I actually had to be better than they were or they'd make fun of me. So I was very strong and still am. If they climbed a tree, I'd have to go a branch higher, and if we were in a two-story barn, I'd have to go to the third story. And so I grew up very strong and with boys, so I played baseball a lot. They were missing someone on the boys' team, they would come and get me. And I would play on the hard balls to the softball with the girls. And then played football. When we went to the fourth grade, they had big fields at the school there, so we played that. I was a tomboy, I guess you'd say.
Farm or in a city-like area?
Back then, my grandfather mowed it with a scythe. He was a terrific scythe man. He cut it all with a scythe, and then he pitched it onto a trailer and put it in the barn.
We lived right next door to my grandmother and my grandfather. It was Lemuel and Ruth Mobbs, and they had a farm. They had cows and goats and chickens, and I would help Grammy pick up the eggs and help with other farm chores. We also, in the summertime, we hayed. Now, he didn't have a baler like they do now. They threw the hay up into a hay wagon, and then my cousin Eddie and I would get on the hay wagon and we trod the hay down so they could get lots of hay into it, which was fun. I mean, and then we'd have a break and go back to the farm, and Grammy would have made donuts and frosted them with chocolate frosting, and we'd have nice cold milk. And so those memories were really good.
Looking back on your life, what events stand out?
Grew up in the Cranberry Bogs. We grew up in the town that Ocean Spray had their original factory. And the man that, Marcus Urian, that started the business was the father of my Sunday school teacher. So I feel like I'm part of Ocean Spray. But my best memories were playing in the Cranberry Bogs because we could go fishing or catching fish or riding our bikes and we had a great time. It was a lot of fun, and nobody would say, you can't be here, you know, it's all right.
She used to have women who'd come to her house for bridge. Bridge was a very popular game then, and almost all the women who came were bridge widows, they called themselves, because their husbands would go out, leave them alone, and they'd go play bridge. And I remember helping my aunt serve dessert, what it called dessert, one night. And I said, can I help you do that, honey? And she said, oh, yeah. She said, it's easy. I said, oh, I mean, this is the bad time of the year to look for fruit and vegetables. And it seems like it was September or October. And she said, oh, I don't have to worry about that, she said. All I do is open a can. She said, and then from there on, it's easy. Well, what do? You open a can, a tin can? Oh, no, she said, I have some canned peaches. We'll use that. Canned peaches? Yeah. Well, she took a slice of sponge cake and flipped a peach upside down on it. Put a little whipped cream around the edges, and there's your dessert.
On Friday nights, as a family, we'd go out to eat. We'd stop at A&W or someplace like that, and we'd have supper. Then we'd ride onto Main Street in Concord, and we'd park. Now, Friday night, the big deal was we'd sit and watch people walk by. We'd sit in the car. Once in a while, Dad and Ma would know somebody, so they'd wave to them or they'd get out and talk to them. Friday night was pretty lively. We sat in the car watching people walk by.
When I was 7 years old, I was struck by an automobile. A driver, DWI. Came up on the sidewalk and hit me, put me in the hospital. And actually, it was the last day of school. I was 7 years old. Last day of school, we were off for summer vacation. And they put me in a hospital the entire summer. And the day that I got out, school started the next day. So it was a heck of a vacation. Broken ribs, severe, serious head injury. The first day of school, I went back. And on my way home, there were men working on a building, fixing the roof or a chimney. And I was walking by, and one of the men dropped a brick off the chimney and hit me off the head again.
During the war, I rode I sang with a group of girls. We were out of high school, it was out of high school. And we used to go into New York City and sing for the Merchant Marines. They were the guys that were on the tankers that went across the northern, in the North Sea, up the north over into Russia, and would get torpedoed. Many of them had been torpedoed. We would go in and sing to them. Our director said that she had been a vocalist with John Philip Sousa, and she had, I can't prove it. She had a different stage name than the name she used, and I'd love to be able to document that's what she could sing. I mean, this lady could sing. I used to drive my father's car. Because we had the farm, we weren't as subject to gas rationing. I had more gas than most people did, because you had gas rationing, you get so much. So I would drive, and I'd have five of my friends with me. And this one night we were going in, and the rear tire on my father's 39 Buick went flat. And the director had a hemorrhage,
Barbara, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? I said, I'm going to change him. Fortunately, I hadn't worn my white dress that night. Changing the rear tire on a car of that type, it was a hydraulic car, not the bumper jacks. You had to get under the car. You had to get this tiny little piece of the top of the jack directly underneath the axle in the right place so you get the right, fortunately it was the right side, you get the right side of the car going up, get almost, I actually was tightening up the lug nuts and a truck driver went by. We hadn't seen another truck driver the whole night, that's how much traffic there wasn't. And the girl, oh, girls, can I help? Yeah, you can tighten the lug nuts. So he did. Oh, wasn't he wonderful? But anyway.
We had, you didn't, of course, have all these other things. So you had organizations. The 4-H was very popular, and Grange was very popular. And we went to, and church was. And I would say we had so much respect for our elders that I feel I was brought up by a village, which is a term that's used, because you went to church, you went, and if the people there told you to not do this or not do that, or you listened and you did not do it. And so, and 4-H is the same thing. You learned a lot of crafts, you learned a lot of the soul to do whatever.
The biggest thing is we used to have a radio. You could hardly hear it, but we had a radio. And now we can go to the moon. The change has been unbelievable. Riding in an automobile for, well, let's say a 1936 car to what we have today. Big change, major, major change.
Have any advice for this generation?
No, not really. I think that most of them are doing pretty good.
Okay, education is going to do two things for you. Right? Number one, it's going to make you independent. You're going to choose what you want to do in life. No one else is going to dictate what you're going to do. If you don't get an education, you're going to start kicking around looking for a job, and you're going to take any job you can get, but you're not going to be doing what you want to do. You're going to be doing what they want you to do. And if that's okay for you, great. But remember, education is going to give you the freedom and independence to be who you want and do what you want.
Slow everything down a little bit and enjoy it. Because it does go by quickly, but I do know it's exciting when you're young and you want to be just a little bit older, and I know what that's like, but enjoy it. Enjoy every day, because you miss out on a lot if you don't. And the people around you, keep them really close. Because you never know how long they're going to be there. So enjoy your life. Don't get frustrated with things, really. It's enjoy the people around you.
A couple of things. One, you're only going this way once, so make the best of it. You know, you have opportunities. If you get an opportunity to do something, take it. If you have a question about something, think of what the consequences of what you can do anything you want, just be aware that there are consequences. But I think my best advice is try to be happy. Treat other people like you want to be treated and be happy.
Learn as much as you can. Listen as well as promote yourself. Listen and serve other people. Find something that you really like to do, not what somebody thinks you ought to do, and go for it. And you don't have to be a number one in whatever it is, but something you enjoy, do it. and just get to help yourself. Don't be too critical of other people. Once you say something or do something wrong, admit it.
I think it's a very difficult generation. You're going to have your hands full politically with the threat of terrorism, which we certainly didn't have in the 50s. In the later 60s, there was the Cold War and fear of bombing and Russia and that sort of thing. But terrorism is a huge step backwards. So fighting that and dealing with poverty is going to be a greater and greater problem.
I don't know, it just seemed like there's so much meanness nowadays that we didn't used to see. You know, I think everybody could just be a little kinder to everybody else. And, you know, not so... Everybody thinks they're the best and the most important and they don't have that much regard for other people. It seems to me anyway, but...
Yeah, you probably better listen to your parents a lot closer than what you have been doing. I think that kids are not as obedient.
You're getting the advice in the church, and I hope you guys are just really listening. I mean, God's going to set you straight. I live with Him. I live with God.
Seek God. I know that's not something you probably want to hear. He's been my savior.